I have my background, and that's far away from India. So that complicates our conversation, I think. I think here in India, it's very important that you recognize the importance of the digital aspect, the progress in the application of computers and networks, and that you try to incorporate this in the more classical way to provide access to information. That is very clear, and that has been happening all over the world. When I look at Belgium and also to many other parts of the world, there is some hesitation at my side to be very, very enthusiastic about the concept of digital libraries. Because in some parts of the world, this is again already obsolete. In the sense that the whole concept of libraries has its root in those classical libraries. And then after digitization, the first phase is that you talk about digital libraries, which is okay. But when you start thinking more and more about it, you see that the digitization, or the change from classical printed hard copy material to computer-based material, you see that this is not a simple transition. It's not the same as working in the same way, but now on a computer. It doesn't work like that. In general, the evolution of society is always working in a way that people have new technology and they want to do the old things with the new technology. And that works for a while, but then people start realizing that maybe it's not the most efficient way to make progress. And then they start really exploiting the new technology in ways that they could not foresee just when they started applying the new technology. I think that is also what we see in the area of digital libraries. So when it comes to, let's say, the younger generation and the education system trying now to educate people to work in a digital library, it's all fine. But I think in India, you will soon see that things have changed. And that speaking about library, using the word library, and still thinking in terms of an organization that is called the library, with a centralized management and a visible collection, and the whole concept of collection, etc. Well, simply transposing this to a computer-based system is fine, it has to be done, but that's not the end. I will put it in a very succinct, a very summarized way. The digital library, the ideal digital library, is perhaps an invisible library, incorporated in life, in society, so that people can have easy, cheap access to the information that they need at the right time, 24 hours a day, which looks nice, attractive, but you see it is very far away from the classical concept of a library. And the effect is probably that people will not think of this service as a library anymore. It will be useful, it will be better than any library can ever provide, but will it be a library? And what will be the collection? I think in future in society, library work will be incorporated in many activities that people have. And certainly it will be very far away from the idea that I'm going to the library to find information. Let's say the future digital library will be everywhere and the services will be very valuable, but the question is, will it be a library? So when it comes to education, the consequence of all this is that I think you should not educate people to use digital libraries, and you should not create managers of digital libraries. I think it is much more important to help people to become fluent in our information society as users and as assistants of other people in providing computer-based services. But again, the question is this library work? If you still call it that way, no problem, but it will be very different from simply transposing the library onto a computer. That is my main message. So I think it's important that education systems, yes, they educate digital librarians or the future digital librarians, but I think it should be very broad. Education is needed. We need many, many managers of information systems because information will be more and more important. Direct access to information, fast access to information will be very important, but it will be far away from the classical concept of a library. That is what we see in companies. That is what we see in universities. Access to information is integrated all over the website of a university, not only in one part, which is the library. Those days have finished. When it comes to education, then, again, digital library education, making managers of digital libraries, all fine. But information will be so important in so many areas of society, I think we should see this very broad. So I would not say we are creating new library managers, up-to-date library managers. I think it's much more important to educate students with the basic principles of information. What is information? What is the importance of information? How to store information on computers? How to make information accessible? And if this is used in a more or less traditional library context, it's fine. If it is used in an e-learning context, it's fine. If it is used within a company to inform management, it is fine. But again, the question is this library work? It is information-based work, and it's very important. Another step further, perhaps, is that I would go more into the ICT part, the computer part, than to the classical library work. Because what I see in the evolution now is that it's rather easy to grasp the concepts of library work, how to work with information, the importance of information. But I see that people, even the managers today of information systems, they have problems understanding the underlying architecture. The systems have become so complicated that it becomes more and more complicated for the managers to assess the quality and the workings, the inner workings of the systems. So there are two strategies. Either you say, I don't understand it, but I don't have to understand it. I'm simply the manager, and it's up to the technicians to maintain the systems, to develop the systems, and I simply apply them. But I think that's a rather dangerous situation. So I'm always promoting that learning should be more directed toward ICT. How do things work? How is the computer doing all this? What is the evolution in the computer technology? Because if you lose contact with what is really happening within the computers, you are more or less, the victim of the machine. And this point has even come up today, even by the creators of the machine learning systems. Even they say, we don't know really what the machine is offering us. Even the people who develop the algorithms. So you can imagine people in the street or so-called library managers, the distance between what they provide and what they have to manage becomes very, very big in a dangerous way. So I think how to cope with this, I think the only way is to educate people more about the systems, about the internal architecture of systems. Maybe that's not attractive. Maybe people want to be educated in talking to users. People in library work perhaps like the social aspects. It's fine. But at least there should be some people who understand the inner workings of the machines. And this is more and more challenging. I see two very important roles. First of all, we should understand that access to information is not free of charge. There are many sources and many discovery tools free of charge, but still there is a lot not free of charge. So I think a role of a classical librarian and also of the future librarians or information access enablers, It will still be to make a collection, but of course not in the classical sense of building a physical collection, but deciding on how to spend money to provide access, I think that will be an essential role. But it is far away of social interaction. And then when it comes to bring people to those sources, I think I'm more radical than you. For me, it will be machine-based. And forget about the social interaction. I will give you an example. My university has 12,000 students. Information services, or let's call it librarians, we have 30. Among those 30, perhaps we have 5 people who have studied about information services. Can you imagine how we can provide a service with 5 people to 12,000 students and 2,000 high-level scientists? It is impossible. It's not impossible. It's impossible in the sense that we cannot go and talk to our users. Those days have gone. Today, we have to develop user-friendly systems. We have to develop a website so that students can come in. They don't need any assistance. They can make their own flow. They can make their own scheme. They can exploit the website. They can find their own way. They can come finally to interesting sources. And then, of course, they must be accessible. Many are immediately free of charge, but the library must take care of delivering the sources, even though they are not free of charge, immediately, within a few minutes, within a few hours, or, in an extreme case, only after a few days. If a library can do that, it's a very nice library. And I want to come back to my previous remark. A good library or a perfect library, certainly in the future, will be an invisible library. This is just an example. Students go to the website. They find, ultimately, what they want. The library delivers all this to their email box, PDF format, scanned book, whatever, very fast. No payment involved. The library becomes invisible, but it will be better than ever. Yes, of course, this is the obvious question, the expected question. Yes, I do have some remarks. First of all, I think before I came, the aims, the goals, the why of the whole system, of the whole development was not clear. I did read the announcement, I did read some web pages, but still it was not clear. It was only when I arrived here and the first lectures came up that the picture was clarified. So as soon as I have heard this, I thought, well, okay, this is it. Now I know what it's all about. So as far as I understand, I will try to repeat in my own words how I see it. Let's say the challenge or the problem is that education is very expensive, and the idea is that something like a digital library can make education less expensive. Again, that's a formulation in a rather radical way, but I think it's reasonable. I think that is what I have understood. So it's mainly, I think, about providing young people access to learning materials, or even better, to materials that are developed to support learning, e-learning, MOOCs, all these systems. And then there are consequences. I have 2. The first consequence is that you still talk about a digital library. But this is not a digital library in a classical way. Most digital libraries are about collecting all kinds of publications, mainly in heritage. Because as soon as I saw the word National Digital Library for India, I was thinking about, you know, the classical manuscripts, digitizing old papers. And it turned out that's not the point. It's very, very different. So I see a confusion. And it goes further than that. What do I see in the room, in the conference, in the workshop? People I know. Librarians, digital librarians. but wait a minute. This is not about digital libraries. It's about learning, about enabling young people to learn and to be productive in society. Of course, there is an overlap, but still. Concretely, I think it's too late now, but I think that for the workshop it would have been nice if we would have been seeing here experts in e-learning. So maybe for the future, I think. It's so obvious that people involved in e-learning should be present in the development of your so-called digital library. I'm sure there are people involved. Also for the metadata structures, you do rely also on metadata structures developed to describe e-learning sources. Of course, you have done that. But to my surprise, the emphasis here is mainly on collecting sources and making these searchable, like any digital library. But I think it's perhaps even more important and more in accordance with your basic goals that experts in e-learning try to modify the system or optimize the system so that it is welcomed by more and more e-learning people. So that is one clear thing that I see. But the confusion does not stop, because it seems that the project is very ambitious, because it's not only about e-learning. I also see slides where heritage comes up. All documents digitized, they will also be incorporated in what you call the digital library. But then I'm getting confused, because what do we want, or what do you want? So perhaps I have to warn the developers that perhaps they are too ambitious. Because the consequence is that it's not clear anymore for people what is the goal, what is the idea, what are the fundamental principles to develop the system. I just give you an example. If you are a student and you want to do e-learning, you are looking for a course at a particular level. That's very important. So the metadata must be there to indicate the level so that it can be matched with the student's level. That's very important. And subject description should be there. And I think you do this, so that's nice. But a completely different audience is a researcher who wants to have access to the contents of important documents related to India. Religion, history, contemporary politics. And then you need a completely different system. Perhaps I should clarify this. For instance, for deep research, you need a deep index on your databases. So ideally, you have an index on the full text of all your documents. But clearly, if you only collect metadata about documents, for research it is almost useless.
So we've been having some of these debates.
And where do you want to go?
I think...